Grace-filled greetings to everyone. Welcome to the video. We're going to get right to the heart of it right now, okay? And that is to say that neither religious people nor non-religious people have any advantage over one another. And actually, neither are following grace. Neither are following grace. Religious people are not any closer to God than non-religious people, and vice versa. The religious person, it doesn't have some inside track, and nor does the atheist or non-religious person have any sort of inside track. Neither are actually following the grace of God. Neither one. So we have this false dichotomy in the world. It's a distraction. It's an intentional trap. We're getting pulled down into these battles between religion and humanism, where the fact is both of them are egotism. Okay, they're both egotism. Religious people pray to a false god, and non-religious people don't pray to a false god. They put their faith in the ego also. They're both putting their faith in ego. One claims the ego is God, and the other claims that the ego is nature or just the universe or something. It's the same. It's the same dichotomy. There's no difference at all, actually. The only way to really connect with God is through the immediate grace in the now and the super positivity that we practice. This is actually orientation towards truth, which is God. And so this needs to be got out in the open. And it's so obvious this morning. It's just like, oh, of course. But nobody wants to say it. Who wants to be the one who says this, right? But we have to, because there's these cultural battles. These cultural battles are just an egoic distraction. The whole thing's an egoic distraction. Religious people, in general, they're not praying to the true God at all. They're not oriented to they're oriented towards the ego and call the ego God. Well, what's the difference whether you call the ego God or not? What's the difference? Is there some difference there? There isn't any difference. So we're hung up on labels, thinking that I'm calling, someone says, well, I'm calling the ego God. And someone else says, no, I'm just calling the ego and following. I'm following the ego, but I'm calling it the ego. And the other says, I'm following the ego, but I'm calling it God. Now, are we supposed to get caught up in the conflict between the two? Where is the conflict, actually? There's no conflict. It's a false conflict. They're both following the ego. Both sides are following the ego. Two sides of the egoic coin. So there's no conflict there. So why should we get caught up in it? It's a false distraction that pulls us away from what we're supposed to be doing, which is genuinely following the grace of God through doing what the grace of God suggests, which is this super positivity practice or training. And you don't see religious people doing this, and you don't see non-religious people doing this. You don't. And the philosophers either. None of them they're all oriented towards the ego. And so someone has to say this. It's a dog and pony show. It's going on. It's ridiculous in the world. And we're supposed to be fooled by that? Well, we're not fooled by it. I'm just as tired of religious people as non-religious people. It's just the same old tired avoidance of truth. Who cares if we avoid truth in the name of God, or if we avoid truth in not in the name of God? Where is the meaningful difference there? Or is it just a superficial label difference? Don't get caught up in saying there's some difference between labels when they're being applied to the same thing. We're arguing over how do we label, water? Is it this label or that label? Or, dirt or whatever. Rock. Is this a way to use our time and attention? Is this the grace of God to get caught up in that? How could it be? The grace of God is to not get caught up in that. That's a sign of the grace of God, is you're not caught up in this false contrasting of labels dichotomy, where there's no dichotomy at all. Is they're both going the same direction. And they're just labeling the direction differently, and you're supposed to be fooled by it. Religious people follow dogma, and they're on autopilot, religious autopilot. Non-religious people follow their dogma, and they're on autopilot. Neither are asking the grace of God, you know, what do I really do? How do I wake up from this dream of arrogance? This sacrificial dream of arrogance. So we've been really hoodwinked by this false dichotomy. But we're not hoodwinked any longer. So we have the grace of God symbolized here as coming into the, as transmitting beautiful flowers of clarity and practice into this world. This is why the set is set up this way. It's symbolic. You have the absolute blackness of non-differentiation of God in terms of no preference, not bestowing any specialness or preference on any of creation. And then you have the white bird symbolizing the grace of God. And then you have a sort of an intermediate area here, which you would call the Dharma kings, who are one with that, and yet close to us in terms of helping us out. And you have the beautiful flowers, which are symbolic of the practice, which is suggested to us by the great Dharma kings and queens. And then you have this blue area, which symbolizes the Dharma princes and Dharma princesses. Dharma means spiritual protection, protecting us from arrogance, the ego, delusion, duality, ineffectiveness, all of that. So full stop in the wow. This is a direct experiencing that we're having. We don't have to label it God or not God, right? This is just a pragmatic. The idea that somehow people invoke the term God is somehow they're on the right track is ridiculous. Or those who avoid the invoking of it are on the right track also. It doesn't mean anything one way or the other. What is the only right practice, skillful means and right practice means something. That's it. The pragmatism of getting the job done, of evaporating their continuity fear. That's grace, is skillful means, right practice, skillful means. That's the grace of God. And avoidance of that is egoic arrogance, continuity fear, really, absurdity. So we start off this video by pointing out this amazing truth that we all know this, but you know, we don't really want to admit to it, or maybe fears of being ostracized or repercussions or whatever, but uh, most people, religious people, are asking, praying to God to protect them from God. Okay, that's the truth. Keep us busy, keep us on track of avoiding God, avoiding reality is what they're praying for. Empower non-awakening is what they really pray to God for. So they're not praying to God, they're praying to the ego. The ego is the only one that empowers non-awakening. And who, do we think that the ego is less egoic when we refer to it as God? No, it just puffs it up even more. So we're not going to get caught up in the righteousness, self-righteousness of religion, nor in the self-righteousness of opposing religion in the name of the ego. Neither one of those. We're not opposing, we're opposed to the empowerment of non-awakening. In whatever, however you want to label it, we're not going to be fooled by shifting of labels when the label's referring to the same empowerment of non-awakening. The family of the ego is always squabbling. Religions fighting religions, secular humanism fighting religion, back and forth. It's all a distraction. Nowhere does either side practice correctly the super positivity that's necessary. They avoid it like the plague. They're all religious people, the way they pray, the way they petition. Oh, it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. There's no effectiveness in that, and they keep moaning and crying about lack of effectiveness, like the rest of us are supposed to accept that this is the parameters of God. It says, well, we've already prayed, to God, and this is the response, and you can't expect any more response than that. No, they haven't prayed to God. They've prayed to the ego. And the humanists are saying, well, look at the lack of effectiveness of your prayer. See, that's why we say there's no God. That's equally absurd, isn't it? Saying that because those who pray to the ego and claim the ego's God have ineffective answers to their prayers means that therefore God doesn't exist at all is an absurdist conclusion, isn't it? You talk about a conspiracy there. I mean, these are two sides of the same coin working together, actually. Religion and humanism are actually working together to distract us away from what is truly effective. Religion claims they're doing the utmost and nothing more can be done. And then humanism claims, well, you're not getting the results, so therefore God must not exist. No, what they should say is that praying to the ego in the name of God is ineffective, therefore the ego is ineffective. That's the conclusion that should be drawn. And in philosophers, same thing, right? All that. Well, then philosophers say, well, let me try to draw some philosophy up between all of this, some egoic philosophy of perspective. There's no right egoic perspective. I mean, what are we doing trying to find a right egoic perspective? Ego is God, ego is not God. I mean, what's the difference? Duality is God or duality is not God. What's the difference? Saying that we can be separate from what we are and then labeling that separation as God or not God, what's the difference? Labeling it as fallen or not fallen, what is the difference? We never fell. We can't fall. How can we fall out of everywhere? How can we fall out of intrinsic spaciousness? So there's no fall. You know, saying, well, we've fallen from God or we've fallen from not God, is the same absurdity. So really, we've just been floundering in this contrasting of labels, this game the ego's playing, that we're playing, really. It's absurdity. Nothing like a nice Saturday morning with chainsaws starting up, right? We've got lots of birds singing in the morning, but we also have this chainsaw starting up. Good. Great. Cloudy morning. Southern storm has cast a different mood upon the landscape today. So we're just looking at this together, just looking at this. So both humanists and religionists are on their high horses, and the humanists have the upper hand. But it's both a drama. It's a drama, Much Ado About Nothing, actually. God is not concerned with labels. People use the term God, but really, it's isness. This is a closer way of putting it, isness. Beyond these letters and words and syllables and sounds and all of this, it's the isness. We can say it's the nowness. The nowness of intrinsic spaciousness. The nowness of isness, the nowness of the intrinsic spaciousness of isness. So I got up this morning wondering, why is grace not working positively for anyone? Well, I said, wait a minute, it's working for me. I'm able to practice in a super positive way. But I look around and nobody else is doing this, really. There's a few. Not many. Not really. There's like abundance training, but that's not really what we're doing. You know, like I'm entitled to this house and the car and a nice life and, you know, those kind of things. That's not really what we're doing here. We're way more super positive than that. It's not I am entitled. I am perfection. I am abundance itself. There's no separation between I and abundance, or I and perfection. And so we're making our way into the correct effective practice. We've been doing this for quite some time. So the ego just plays games of labels, and it just keeps relabeling itself and say, okay, is that good? Is that good? Is that good? Is that good? That's ridiculous, isn't it? We should not play on its playing field. You know, we should just simply do the practice. Super positivity practice. Early in the morning here. That's why the birds are out singing. It makes a nice background. What time did the chainsaw start? Well, it started at 8 o'clock. There's an ordinance at 8 o'clock. They should probably, though, make it both Saturday and Sunday. You cannot work. And people should be undisturbed. Saturday morning too, really, right? So, you are going to see some fiery leaders on the right, super agitated. The right is going to get, conservative religious people are going to get very agitated, fighting for their position. And we must recognize that this is the ego too. This is just the ego. It's a distraction, continuity for distraction from what really works. We're afraid of awakening, and we just have to admit that this is the whole key, because we're afraid this is our annihilation. Because when we awaken, we'll realize there's only beingness. There's only intrinsic spaciousness. There's no such thing as non-intrinsic spaciousness. There's no such thing as an absence of intrinsic spaciousness. We think we've created an absence of reality, an absence of intrinsic spaciousness, and therefore this is our claim to being a prime creator. This is our claim. And when we see there is no such thing, then how can our claim that stand, that we're a prime creator separate from God? It can't stand. And therefore we say, oh, therefore what I am, prime creator, that doesn't exist, therefore I don't exist. This is an absurdist conclusion. It's absurdist logic, isn't it? So we have to keep looking at this absurdist logic, because this is really at the root of our terror of the abyss of annihilation. And this is the root of our trying to empower non-awakening. And both religion and non-religion are engaged in empowering non-awakening. Okay, this is a fact. And the empowerment of awakening generally does not really cast itself as a religion. They look at religion as this gradualist, you know, avoidance of awakening, actually. You do everything but awaken to truth. Go through all these rituals and rigmarole and gradualism and stuff and trying to develop good character and everything. That's avoiding awakening. It's the empowerment of non-awakening. Trying to make a bargain with awakening as if there's something other than, you know, truth to abide in. Is something other than spaciousness to abide in? It really is there? It's like the ego saying, well, okay, we can't have intrinsic spaciousness because that would prove that we're not a prime creator. And we can't have lack of intrinsic spaciousness because that's not true. That's denying God. So what else is there? You know, this is what we say. Okay, so what else is there? So we're thinking, like, we got to be fair to ourselves, got to be fair to both the ego and God. So, you know, what is there? Is it, well, this is ridiculous. The idea that there's something that is neither intrinsic spacious nor denial of it is absurdity. So that's obviously not the way. That's still empowering non-awakening. Now, religious people are used to saying that they have a better way to empower non-awakening, so everybody else needs to, put them on a pedestal and do what they say. And now humanists are coming along and saying they have a better way to empower non-awakening. And so there's this fight among the two. But the claim is the same. Its claim is how to empower non-awakening. And the only squabble is, well, how to do that? We're not interested in empowering non-awakening. We know how to empower awakening. That's our focus here. You go out in the secular humanist world, are they empowering awakening? Not at all. Just the opposite. They're fanatics about empowering non-awakening. Then you go to church services, religious services, are they empowering awakening? Not at all. They're empowering non-awakening, and they're fanatics about doing so. They're both fanatics. Both sides are fanatics. They're fanatical loyalists to zealots about empowering non-awakening, fanatic zealots about empowering non-awakening. It's just they disagree about, what's the most effective way to do so. The one side labels our death as the death of God. God is dying. The other side says, well, let's not even worry. Let's not label it that way. And that'd be more effective. Why beat a dead horse sort of thing. So they're both totally into sacrifice. The belief system of sacrifice. It's just they just throw different labels up. There's no real difference at all. No real difference. No meaningful difference, really. One pays lip service, to the grace of God and all this kind of stuff. But they don't follow the advice of grace. So are they listening to the grace of God, praying to it or not? No, they're hoping the ego has grace to empower non-awakening is what they're really praying for. It's like they're saying, ego, I'm terrified. I feel that God is threatening me with awakening. And so can you please get rid of God and please empower non-awakening, and we'll worship you as God if you do this. So please give us a skillful means to not awaken. That's really what they're praying for. And the humanists, they pray to the actresses and actors and, entertainers and politicians or whatever. They pray, and they pray to them, please, please empower my non-awakening. You seem to have the grace, oh great leader, to help me, avoid awakening. So, they make idols out of politicians and things. What's the difference? You make an idol out of a politician or you make an idol out of Jesus? What's the difference, actually? There's no difference, is there? I mean, you could use any, you can pray to Jesus, but make an idol out of Jesus and ask Jesus to help you empower non-awakening for you. What's the difference? It's the same purpose as praying to a president or a candidate or, entertainer or something. People think that if they pray to Jesus to help empower non-awakening, that somehow they're more righteous. That's absurd. We could always make an idol out of anything, really. I mean, and use it for the purposes of non-awakening. There's nothing preventing us from doing that. It's not like if you use the label Jesus, and your intention is to empower non-awakening, that somehow Jesus will step in and say, no, you can't do that. Yeah, we're absolutely free. We have free will. There's no intrinsic prohibition that means, well, just because I use a label Jesus, that means therefore I must not be, you know, empowering non-awakening. It doesn't work like that. God does not give special preference anywhere. So we can make an idol out of God. We can make an idol out of Jesus. We can make an idol out of any religious figure and pray to that idol, which is really the ego. We can just use the label God and attach it to the ego, and we're really just praying to the ego. And it's not like God says, "Oh, you use the label God, you must not be praying to the ego." That's ridiculous, isn't it, to think that way? That somehow labels have some magical power like this. Ask for is what we receive. If we want non-awakening, that's what we receive. It doesn't matter what name we pray for it in. We're just hoping if we use the term Jesus, the empowerment of non-awakening will be more effective. Well, it might be. I mean, if we believe in it really powerfully, non-awakening, that would be more effective, right? For us, maybe the humanists are saying, you know, rejecting the name of Jesus to empower non-awakening is more effective for them. So they think, well, that's more effective. The principle is, what are we asking for? What are we empowering? We're either empowering non-awakening to truth or awakening to truth. That's it. There isn't some third category between intrinsic spaciousness and the belief in its absence. There's no third category in terms of reality or the denial of reality. There's no third category, is there? Now, Jesus speaks of we can have a happy dream that helps us awaken, but that's not a third category. It's still dreaming. Or he says we can have these illusions that more accurately reflect what we are. But they're still illusions. There's no third category whatsoever. And our continuity fear is telling us, well, there's got to be a third category. This is the pretty much the heart of our delusion, isn't it? That continuity fear suggests that there's this, you know, in a desire to not awaken, it says, oh my gosh, I'm so attracted to awakening, but I must not awaken, I'll be annihilated. So there must be some third category. What we're really saying is, well, there must be some way to be prime creator. Okay, this is what we're really saying. Okay, so I can't create an absence of reality as prime creator. Okay, so what can I create? There must be something I can create. This is, okay, let's just look at this together here and not be frightened to look at this and have a good laugh at it, because this is what we're really saying, isn't it? People say, okay, I see what you're saying, that we cannot create an absence of spaciousness, inherent spaciousness. Okay, I got it. All right, so now what can we create separate from God? Yeah, it must be something. So let's find out. Let's find what that is. Third category, you know. Yeah. So let this sink in. This is like, wow. Okay, I see what we're doing, which is great. We're supposed to find our mistakes and correct them here. This is what we're doing. And this is a crucial mistake, isn't it? We can see that everything that we have imagined to be without intrinsic spaciousness are having a separate intrinsic spaciousness that somehow that the intrinsic spaciousness somehow stops somewhere, which we call form, we can see that that's not true, but we don't have to get rid of the ornamentations that we've imagined, right? But that's not a third category. It's not a category of us being a separate prime creator okay, now this is our separate creation. No, it's not like that at all. So this bee sting on my right hand has just been ferocious. The agitation on the right hand, I've never experienced anything like it. I couldn't stop scratching it. It's just so severe, fiery irritation, and it's still bad, but not as bad as it was yesterday. This is a sign given unto me that the right, the religious right, is going to become extremely agitated at some point, extremely irritated. And they're going to look for some fiery savior, you know, to step up. And the ego saying, hey, why don't you do it? You can protect God. You can protect, what do you mean? God is just a label that we're using to try and sanctify the ego and to empower non-awakening. That's our purpose. I mean, labels don't have an intrinsic purpose of their own. Symbols don't have any intrinsic purpose of their own. So that's how we're using it. That's how we've used it. That's how religion uses God, the label God. Now we can use the term God and use it to empower awakening also, right? Or not. It doesn't matter. It's what your purpose is what matters. Not the label you attach to the purpose. That's completely superficial. So the right is under siege. At least they think so. In terms of, you know, how they're afraid they're going to lose their ability to empower non-awakening. But really, they don't lose it because secular humanism is all about that as well. It's all about that. So who's closer to God, an atheist or a religionist? Neither. The question is, who is practicing empowering awakening? That's the question. And that's it. So one who's practicing is simply one who is practicing. That's all. There doesn't need to be a label attached to it, religious or non-religious or anything like that. Neither does there not need to be labels attached. It's just superfluous, that's difficult to say early in the morning. I'm smelling this scent, you know. It was this beautiful scent in the morning. Well, it's probably the roses, I would imagine. Yeah. So the scent of God's grace is the empowerment of awakening. And the grace of God suggests effective practices to us. So I'm not paying attention to either the right or the left. I'm not paying attention to the news. I'm not paying attention to what's going on. It doesn't matter. Those are just birds of a feather flocking together, actually producing this theater of distraction. Some people say they love it, some people say they hate it, but they still follow it. It's a theater of distraction. And it's very theatrical now. There's probably no better theatrical show going on ever. I mean, it's just, it's a massive production, worldwide production, what's going on in the world now. It's all just the theater of distraction, is all that it is. It's all that it is. That's why Longchenpa retreated to cave. Yeah, he was the head of the most important monastery in Tibet, the Samye Monastery. And the original monastery, he was the top dog, the chief, and he left. He left. He says, the squabbles, all these squabbles, this is just distraction, actually. So many, squabbles over labels, right? And so he left and went to live in a cave and disappeared and just lived in a cave. And he says, that's my advice, is don't get caught up in these, the spiritual ambition of squabbling and label. It's all a distraction, a theater of distraction. There are many, many, many labels and ways we can try to empower non-awakening. In fact, we're very inventive and creative about it. But so what? I mean, what is that? We can see it's invested with our creativity, and that in some way can remind us of our greatness, the greatness of God. But do we really need to draw distinctions among any of it? What does that get us? If we find the right, quote unquote, right label for empowerment of non-awakening, does that mean we are going to be happy with non-awakening? Is that what it really means? No, how can we be happy with non-awakening? We still have this dread. Here's the dynamic, okay? When we're dreaming of absence of reality, that we've created an absence of reality, the truth is we haven't left reality, we're just dreaming. And so the attraction to awakening from this belief in the absence of reality is this tremendous, ferocious attraction. This fragrant, we say, super fragrant attraction. We keep smelling the roses and saying, what is that wonderful smell? What is that wonderful essence I'm smelling? Like, oh, that reminds me of something so wonderful. What is that? And then we panic, say, oh, no, if I awaken, I will be nothing. So we say, how do I get rid of that remembrance? How do I get rid of it? How do I empower non-awakening? So we feel threatened by God, by reality, because we're attracted to awakening. And this is unavoidable. There's no way we can ever empower non-awakening where the fragrance of remembrance is permanently extinguished. It's impossible. We can bury ourselves under blocks of granite, and yet even there, the fragrance of remembrance is there. And therefore, the threat we feel of annihilation is there. So in this dream, we always have this threat of annihilation. And it's impossible to dream this dream without the threat of annihilation. And so what we do in desperation is try to annihilate remembrance by symbolizing it as many fragments and then killing these fragments, which we call bodies, nature, things, form, thoughts, all concepts, all this stuff. These are just symbols of this threat. and trying to break this threat down into pieces so it's more manageable. You know, when you feel something's unmanageable, it seems to be too difficult to deal with. What do? We start fragmenting it in our mind and breaking it down to smaller pieces, and say, okay, I can deal with this little piece of it, one piece at a time, we might say. So, you know, one body at a time, we'll kill one body at a time is the way we look at it. And we have this vast assembly line of sacrifice. And we hope that will rid us of the fragrance of remembrance, so that we're not tempted to awaken in which we think is our annihilation. This is what's really at play here. This is what's at play. This is the play. But, you know, if we wake up and realize that we cannot create an absence of reality, then how can we imagine that we ourselves are absent from reality? How is that possible? Because to say that we're therefore annihilated would mean that we're absent from reality. There's nothing that can be annihilated in reality. There's only intrinsic spaciousness. How can that be annihilated? So, to say that we would be annihilated if we realize that we can't create an absence of reality, this is our, you know, absurdity. That's just what is that? So we need to keep looking at that, and at some point it will dawn upon us. That it's only a thought. Absurdity, that these are only thoughts. But thoughts also arise in intrinsic spaciousness. So when we shift to just viewing intrinsic spaciousness, that's it. We're free of fear. And we didn't do anything to get rid of any thoughts, right? So awakening is just this willingness to shift to seeing intrinsic spaciousness as primary. And then we realize that, oh, whatever thoughts arise, they've never strayed from intrinsic spaciousness either. So the thought that will be annihilated if you know, this is a thought, if we fail to see an absence in reality, is just a thought that itself is within intrinsic spaciousness. And therein lies the peace of God. So it is just this very simple shift, and we need to keep emphasizing this. Awakening to intrinsic spaciousness is just a willingness to see intrinsic spaciousness. And then we no longer feel threatened by our thoughts one way or the other. Thoughts are no longer threatening at all, or frightening. Because it's only our thought, an absurdist thought, of saying that, well, if I see I can't create an absence in reality, that means I'm absent from reality. What it is, the thought is, I'm absent from being prime creator. But the prime creator did not create any absence at all. So how can we be absent? Say that we're being absent from being prime creator is just a thought. It's an absurdist thought. It doesn't mean anything, really. And yet we have that thought. But that, again, is also at its own, there's intrinsic spaciousness in that thought. So when we can see that thoughts also are just arising in intrinsic spaciousness, no matter what the thought, even the thought of absence is arising in intrinsic spaciousness. And our thoughts have no power, actually, at all, in terms of absence, right? In terms of leaving intrinsic spaciousness, when that can dawn upon us, then we can have a perspective of intrinsic spaciousness. You know, that is awakening. It's not getting rid of thoughts that is awakening at all. That just perpetuates the problem. We don't have to get rid of thoughts or kill thoughts or anything like that. That's an insecurity, isn't it? What are we doing? Creating an absence of thought? You see, that still ties into the idea of absence. Or absence of ego, or absence of... There's no absence in reality. What never existed, which is absence can hardly be said to be absent. So we say, like Ramana Maharshi says, well, you see, that the I never was. It never was there. Does that mean the I is absent? Well, if something has never been there, how can we then claim that it's absent? That it has an identity, but it's absent of that identity. You know, this is an absurd thought, isn't it? So see, we're not talking about religion here, are we? Or non-religion. We're talking about the root of our trouble. So we say, oh, the I is absent. There's no I. Does that mean the I is absent? Well, if there's no I at all, never has been, how can we say it's absent? How can we say something is, if we say there's nothing at all in terms of absence, there is no absence. When we say there's nothing, there is no absence from reality, from intrinsic spaciousness. So then how can we claim that something is absent, that it's absent, that absence is absent? That's really what we've been claiming all along, that absence is absent. Oh, there's an absence of absence. Oh my gosh, how terrible. There's an absence then. Absence is absent. What it just means is we cannot be a separate prime creator. But is that mean, oh, being a separate prime creator is absent? Is impossibility meaning, oh my gosh, that's terrible. There's an absence of impossibility. Okay, so we don't need to answer this so much, except that let's look at it with good humor, and realize this is an absurdity. But the absurdity also is present in intrinsic spaciousness, right? We just have to see that intrinsic spaciousness is also present, no matter how we fashion absurdity. It's also, this is a thought in intrinsic spaciousness, just a thought. It's not an absence, it's a thought. No matter how absurd our thoughts are, they're still thoughts in arising in intrinsic spaciousness. So just looking at this, just looking at it without thinking that there's something that has to be solved necessarily, right? Some absence that needs to be solved. There's no absence that needs to be solved. We just have to be willing to just look at it in terms of intrinsic spaciousness. That's not solving an absence. So we can do this, and then we stop doing it. And so why do we stop doing it? Is because the dilemma isn't quite clear to us, that people claim there's a dilemma. And they say, well, wait a minute, you know, we there's an absence of absence. And how do you solve that? You know, there isn't any need to solve it. That too is just a thought. So they're trying to hold on to their prime creatorness by the notion of being prime creator, by saying, well, I'm at least the prime creator of this absence of absence. Is that a third category? The absence of absence? Is that really something we can lay claim to? Because that's what we're doing. When we're not abiding in the awareness of intrinsic spaciousness, we're laying claim that there's, you know, an absence of absence. This is our claim to fame. I don't think about this. I mean, just feel the wow of this. Just wow. It's really this obvious. It's really this transparent, huh? To stay with the wow, this my mind is trying to drift. Wander around. Don't let it wander around. Are we really withholding truth from ourselves? Or is it just a thought that we're refusing to see also arises intrinsically in pure space, inherent pure spaciousness? Are we trying to establish it in pure spaciousness? Trying to establish the thoughts? Oh, okay, I got to establish. Or has it always been there? It's always been the case. And so does reaction. Oh, that means I've never been prime creator. Is that an absence? Or is it just a thought in spaciousness? Is it an absence of being prime creator? Or is it just a thought of the absence of being prime creator? Now this is what the Dharma kings and queens want us to look at. They just want us to look at this carefully. And this is where they direct our attention. The great Dharma king Longchenpa is extraordinarily helpful in his emphasis. Is where he's very, very adept in saying, look, drop all this other stuff. It's much ado about nothing. Just put your attention here. And, you know, he carries a lot of weight when you're the top, you know, the top dog, the chief, the highest in terms of people feeling that you need to be the, you know, the head of this great monastery, this great religious, you know, endeavor, and then you know, this carries a lot of weight, and then so he says, no, you know, I leave that, and he writes all these books and explaining, you know, exactly what the situation really is. And, you know, the teachers that he had, and he carries massive weight, massive weightiness here. Someone, you know, an insider, you might say, who's really experienced very experienced in all this, in turning away from, you know, all elaborate titles and positions and praises and all of this. This carries a lot of weight, doesn't it? And the ability to, you know, resolutely tell us, you know, where to put our attention is extremely helpful. That's what the Dharma King does. It is being extremely helpful by this resolute and very weighty emphasis. So when someone of great, great, great spiritual renown gives us this emphasis and says, no, just this, just look at this, it's very helpful. He says, don't focus on the pomp and circumstances of anything in particular. Just look at this. Is the thought of the absence of absence, is that an absence? Or is it just another thought? And he says thoughts too arise in intrinsic spaciousness. Don't try to get rid of thoughts. But of course we think thoughts themselves are absent from intrinsic spaciousness. So we just see that no thought is absent from it. It doesn't matter what the thought is. We don't need to draw distinctions. So what's important to see is that thoughts arise as ornamentation of their own intrinsic spaciousness. No matter what the thought is, it doesn't matter what the content, supposed content. The content is ornamentation of its own intrinsic spaciousness. That's the content of all everything that arises, whether we call it a thought or don't call it a thought. Are there really thoughts? Not really. They're just ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness, is how Longchenpa would put it. A thought about thoughts is still a thought, isn't it? A thought about absence of absence is still a thought. How is that thought absent from it's from an ornament being an ornament of its own intrinsic spaciousness? How is that absent? Okay, so this is see this you see where what we're getting at here. And getting to this is the grace of God. It's the grace of isness. And God is. Isness is. Have others emphasized this? Yes, absolutely, in various ways. The Dharma princes and princesses, and the Dharma kings and queens, this is what they're getting at. But thoughts about that are also ornaments of intrinsic spaciousness. All is ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness. Everything that arises and not arises. Non-arising is also ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness. So just like this black might be is ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness, and this white bird is also ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness. Intrinsic spaciousness is beyond arising and not arising. Arising and not arising, both are all of that is ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness. We say God is the base of being, the root of being, the base of it. So it's both arising, ornamentation and non-ornamentation both arise as intrinsic spaciousness. We might say this is, you know, the deepest, you know, insight of seeing this. But we're just looking at this. Don't be worried. Oh, I don't quite get that. Well, no, just sort of take a glimpse of it. That both arising and non-arising. Everything is already present. Everything is already, quote unquote, arising. It beyond that, it is present. It's just what we put our attention on, as far as experiencing, seems to arise as an experience. But that experience is already there. You call it potentiality, but it's reality. So when we put our attention on something, it's not that we're creating it. It's already been created. We're just choosing to emphasize it in our experiencing. It's something along those lines. Therefore, we call reality ineffable, non-definable. So can we have a thought about it? The thought about it is also it. Everything is it. Can we have an absence of it? That thought also is it. So can there actually be an absence? Of course not. I mean, so we cannot be a separate prime creator. There's nothing that we could create that isn't already created. All creation is in the now. Creation is already created. We just look at this. We don't have to intellectually seize it, put it in a box. We're just getting used to this is super positive, part of super positive practicing. This is flipping the script here is what we're doing. We have three parts to our practice, flipping the script. Which is looking at this like assertions, affirmations, assertions, and full stop in the wow. So we're flipping the script here for the most part. And the wow is coming up also, and some assertions also come up. So those three are always in play here. Now, this is the grace of God to be able to focus on this like this. Very powerful grace of God. And the mind wants to wander. It tends to pretend it's not interested. You say, oh, okay, yeah, that's very fine, but I'm going to wander over here. And so we kind of try to keep that from happening, too much wandering. We think, well, we can create an absence by lack of form, but is there really form? Is anything actually born? We think if it dies, there's an absence. Was it ever born, really? Is creation ever born, or is it self-existent already? I had to drink a caffeine drink yesterday. I was so exhausted. I was driving and it is so dangerous. I realized the symptoms coming on. What I found is this drink, which it keeps me from falling asleep at the wheel in emergencies, but it doesn't have such bad side effects. What is terrible is, like Coca-Cola, soft drinks are terrible. The after effects, the jitteriness in the next day is horrible. Coffee is terrible, especially strong coffee, it's terrible. Most energy drinks are pretty terrible. What I got is a Starbucks protein, espresso protein or double shot protein or whatever I'm not sure what it's called. Sort of in a light yellowish, beigeish kind of can. 20 grams of protein on it, it says. For some reason, there's no jitters there, and I'm able to sleep, and I feel pretty much normal today. Interesting. And I'm sure it has some, after effects. But the after effects are way milder. I don't know if it's blending it with a lot of cream or protein and vitamins or something. I don't know why that is. But I certainly know there's a huge difference. Boy, if I drink like a Coca-Cola, it's bad. I suffer terribly from that. So out with the soft drinks, folks. I mean, do not go for soft drinks. They're nasty. And out with the coffee, too. Coffee's very nasty. If you have to, an emergency. And, I'm just pragmatic. I can't, in this traffic here, I can't afford to lose concentration for an instant. And this is why sleep deprivation's a big problem for me, which is what's happening now. And it's various reasons. So I need to be liberated from this situation. I can't, the strain and stress of the path and trying to drive in Silicon Valley traffic, which is some of the worst traffic in the world right now, and doing it all day, for 8-9 hours straight driving in this is just brutal and dangerous. It's mostly young people driving, the older people having so much trouble. It's intimidating them, very intimidating. The breakdown of civilization is apparent in Silicon Valley, is the scofflaw, the amount of scofflaw that is taking place here is just extraordinary. You can see the decline in civility, in adherence to law and order. It's terrible. One way of telling it is the trucks. The trucks have abandoned their great ethics that they've always had. I've always had great respect for truck drivers, for the Teamsters, for those who drive trucks, okay? They're great drivers, and they know the rules. They don't scoff, they're not scofflaws. They follow the rules, they always have. So I always feel, that on the road you're safe with trucks, and they're diligent about it. But now that's it's as if they've completely thrown all the laws out the window. They no longer follow the rules of the road anymore. It's crazy. Big trucks, the biggest, they're simply driving in every lane except the fast lane now, and sometimes even in the fast lane. Now, I haven't yet seen them just cruising in the fast lane, but I have seen them cruising in all other lanes. They're supposed to cruise in the slow lane and only use other lanes for passing. Now, if it's a really big multiple lane freeway, apparently they're able to use the second lane. Now, I don't know if they have the right to cruise in that lane or not. Maybe they do, but most certainly they don't have the right to cruise in any other lanes. Okay, the right two lanes is it. And they are cruising, and even so, if the cruising in the second lane is only if the right lane is obstructed, you know, and really crowded or something because of exiting and cars coming onto it, that's understandable. But if that's not the case, and then they don't have the right to cruise in the second lane. If the right lane is open, okay, then they are supposed to be in the right lane. They're not doing it anymore at all. They're going into the second lane and the third lane and just cruising. I can't believe it. They've never done this before. This unless the laws have been radically changed, they are simply throwing the laws out the window. Now, I was driving day before yesterday and just going with the flow of traffic. And suddenly I saw this police car go with its lights on, go past me, just, you know, I go, whoa. I say, well, good thing I'm not speeding. And then I looked at the speedometer. I said, oh my gosh. Because everybody was, you know, everyone's going the exact same speed. So I'm just thinking, okay, everything's fine. No, everyone was way over the speed limit. But the police, they don't pay any attention anymore to that. And apparently they're not paying any attention to the trucks, which is terrible because everybody then has to pass the trucks and everyone's weaving around these trucks into the slower lanes and faster lanes. It is very dangerous, very, very dangerous. The weaving in traffic now is the greatest danger of all. And these younger people with their fast cars, they're turning into just these insane weavers now. Just cutting across traffic at high rates of speed. This is just insanely dangerous because the tolerances are minuscule for what they're doing. Now, it used to be you'd see one of these weavers and that's it, just one, and you'd say, oh, that's horrible. Now, it's happening all over the place. This is a breakdown of law and order and in safety, in public safety, on an unprecedented scale. And the police are just overwhelmed. They've got most of them just parked by some road crew who's like cleaning up the side of the road, and you've got like, you know, two or three police parked there following them. What is that? I also create a new division of civil servants whose job is to do this, hang out with construction crews and make sure, I don't know what they're doing there in particular, but they're certainly not ticketing these truck drivers. You know, they should have these checkpoints and just start ticketing these truck drivers. And when you talk about public safety, which is very, you don't realize how important public safety is until it breaks down. And it is broken down in the Silicon Valley to an extreme extent. And part of it is the power that these tech companies have. They don't want their workers ticketed. You know, if some for these big, powerful tech companies are all here, if their employees, you know, get ticketed, driving to, you know, to work, being weaving and stuff, they're going to go and say, hey, you know, to the bosses and the power brokers, say, hey, you know, we can't, that's not fair, you know, we can handle our business on the road, you know. They do this. They have extreme power here in the Silicon Valley and the Bay Area in general, these tech companies. I mean, they run the show here. And apparently, they've just let the powers that be, who oversee the police and public servants, and said, hey, you know, back off. We need to drive fast, okay? We need to, you know, don't enforce all these laws. And so they just stopped enforcing them. That's the kind of power they have. I mean, they have just insane power in California. And nobody else does, really. You and me, we don't have any power in California. And around the world, it's become that way. It's the tech companies that run the state, basically. and the police don't have any power anymore, really. They can't just decide unilaterally what to do. They don't have that power anymore. They can't say, okay, we're going to start ticketing these weavers. They don't. Now, you still have small town cops just being tax collectors, which is ridiculous. Oh, you didn't stop 3 seconds at a stop sign. Or you went over the crosswalk. That's what they do, like in Palo Alto. They get these squads of police. And if you don't stop, if your bumper is touching the white paint of the crosswalk, then you get ticketed. Is that really endangering public safety? Is it really? Or is that tax collecting? An unjust tax. It's like a Tea Party tax thing. I mean, you'd be taxing the tea, right? I mean, this that's not ticket the tech company weavers and their fast sports cars who are just, you know, weaving on their way, cutting there to get to their tech job faster. Ticket them. Do they ticket them? I've never seen it. I've never seen it. It's infuriating because public's, I feel my safety is extremely, and I feel extremely endangered on the roads of California now. That is not what I want in California. That's not, it's not just, it's not right. Nobody should suffer public endangerment to that extent. I think everybody except the young people feel quite, and even some of the young people, I had a young person tell me, he says he feels very endangered driving. I said, thank you for being honest like that. He says, yeah, I mean, and it's the young people that are doing it, he says. They don't follow the laws anymore. They feel the laws don't apply to them. The tech company people feel they make the laws. They're making the rules. The law, old rules don't apply to them at all. This is their mindset. It's a juvenile mindset. As I've said before, the juveniles are running the show now. And it's not fair to the older people. It's extremely ageist, you know, very, very discriminating. In the field that they can just, you know, they're driving 85, 90 miles an hour and weaving regularly now. Okay, that is not safe. Now, you have weaving in Indian cities, in China, you know, Eastern Asian cities, whatever. Okay, yeah, but they're going 25 miles an hour when they're weaving. You know, they're jostling here, just cutting in here and stuff. But the traffic's basically much at a standstill. Okay, that's a different story than weaving at 90 miles an hour. Like they do here. And they all understand, yeah, it's going to take me a long time to get to my destination, and that's all, they all understand it, and accidents don't happen hardly at all there. It's quite amazing. But here, it's a different story. Accidents happen all the time here. It's an insane juvenile entitlement mentality here in the Bay Area. It's one of the most worst places in the world, actually, but it's everywhere, though, right now in the world, isn't it? Juveniles hate authority. They hate rules. They really do. They feel that these rules should not apply to me. I have these, you know, uber reflexes and awareness. Yeah. But guess what? You know, you screw up, too, and you get in accidents, too. Because you keep pressing the line, and you're being extremely disrespectful to older people, you know, people over 30 or 40, you're being like oblivious to them, you know. The whole idea of law and order is it recognizes the situation here of older people too. And I know going through juvenile, you feel like, why should I look out for these older people? And you're hostile towards them. Okay, this juveniles are hostile to older people, inherently hostile. And if we don't recognize that fact, it's a fact. I admit this fact for myself and everyone I knew growing up. When you go through these juvenile phases, you're hostile towards authority, okay? This is just a phase. But when you institutionalize this phase and put that phase on top, you're creating a vicious society. And this is what we have. This is what we have now. An extreme disrespect for older people. An abhorrent disrespect for older people is what we have now. Now, older people, and old age tends to be more conservative because their reflexes are not. I'm not as good a driver as I used to be. Guess what? That's not really a newsflash, is it? When you're 60, you're not as good a driver as you were when you were 20. I used to be a weaver in a sports car. I used to have a really hot-rodded sports car. And I was a great weaver. You know, and somebody, an older person, yelled at me and said, "Hey, slow down, you're going to kill somebody sometime." And I realized, yeah, it's probably going to be me. I realized they're right. Or I could be a cat, someone's cat, or a child, or something. And I realized they were right. And from that moment, it just struck me that here's an adult. You know, guess what? Adults used to be able to say that. Here's an adult pointing out my juvenility, and very soon after I sold the car, and that was the end of my hot rodding days, and I realized they're right, I'm wrong. And that was the end of my juvenility, you know, if some adults spoke up because they felt they had the right to, and nobody was going to censor them or, you know, sue them or, you know, claim they're an evil person for speaking up. And that was the day, you know, my juvenility, you know, that I said, okay, it's time to grow up. But what we've done now is we've done away with the safeguards of a sane society and turned it into a juvenile society. And this has now been enculturated in the laws. And we've told older people, hey, you can be juveniles too. Well, guess what? It doesn't quite work that way. Now, they're saying your option is either to age and get old or be a juvenile. Well, guess what? We have another option. That's to be enlightened. Now, we may not age then. We may not feel any fatigue then. But we also won't be juveniles. And we also won't suggest that somehow society should refuse to recognize, you know, the facts that in delusions people do age. This in the sacrificial belief system, people do age, and you know, we're all driving fast now. But my fast is not as safe as other fasts. But the pressure is there. The intense pressure is there, and it's the juveniles that are endangering it and pushing the whole thing too fast. It's out of control. Overconfidence. Their juveniles are extremely overconfident, aren't they? They think they know it all. They think they know it all. Right? When you were a juvenile, didn't you think that you knew better, best? That was just because you could dodge danger faster, and so you thought that you somehow knew. That's not knowing at all. It's just having quicker reflexes. And so in a sane society, juvenility is recognized as such, and it's not worshipped. It is not put in control of society as it is now in control of society. It's the same thing with the idea of mother knows best. That's also a juvenile attitude. Remember, throughout history, a lot of mothers have been young. I mean, start having children at 14, 15, 16. A lot of rural societies, I ask people from those societies, when did you have to start having children? 14, 15, 16. They're juveniles. 17, 18, 20, 22, 23, 24. They've had 6 children already. And they think they know best. They're still juveniles. They still have a juvenile mentality. The idea that mother knows best is itself a juvenile mentality. And the capacity for like young women to multitask and all this stuff is because of their youth, okay? And they misinterpret that as thinking that the mother knows best. It is not true. Mother does not know best. That's a juvenile, another juvenile attitude. So this coalescence of mother knows best feminism with youth knows best high-tech stuff, this is a super toxic brew. Super toxic brew. And they've changed the laws of the nation, changed the laws of the world. And it's all about speed, speed, more speed, more speed, more speed, more speed. So we're just talking about this to help kind of cool down from this intense examination of absurdity as we have done. So we don't let our thoughts wander just aimlessly, you know, we keep some focus here. So California is basically no longer taking care of public safety, really. Cutting police forces, you know, abandoning law and order to a large extent. Chipping away at it. Very juvenile attitude. So much of the cultural revolution has really just been juvenile revolution. Very, very ill-conceived, a lack of a bigger picture. And such societies are really very distracted from the type of clear examination of what an honesty and what we've been looking at here. They always have something to do. They have that they need to go. You know, I got to do this right away. Or I got to do this faster. They always have this pressure of speed. Like I feel I'm endangered. I need to go faster. This is a way to avoid awakening. To empower non-awakening, one of the main ways is to go faster. I need to speed up my distraction. I need to recognize endangerment in as some over here. You know, this is called displacement. So we instead of recognizing the endangerment we're feeling as coming from God, intrinsic spaciousness, where there is no absence, we project it onto bodies and situations of, so let's threaten the existence of the body by driving crazy and lack of laws and criminality and all these wars, whatever. And so you say, okay, well, that's the danger. You know, that's the danger. Displacement. And then struggling with that displacement and thinking that, oh, okay, we'll just allow the threat to our body to take place as if that's enlightenment. This is a very juvenile approach to enlightenment. Ridiculous, isn't it? So we think, oh, I'm accepting the threat to my body, so I'm not concerned about threat. I've made peace with threat. That's not awakening. That's still empowering non-awakening. So it's a lack of pragmatism is what we have here. And arrogance, so I'm not going to age. We all have it. Right, we all have it, but in the back of our mind, we all realize, you know what? It probably is. I probably am going to age. Not that we necessarily have to, but the alternative isn't juvenility either. So, when you see, you know, when I'm driving, when I see people driving slower. And I'm under so much pressure to drive fast, get some places fast, so much pressure. I say, you know what, they're probably an elder person. Maybe someone of my age. So, it's okay, it's okay. And yet, we still have to weave, don't we, around them. Which is sad. The demand for speed is itself, you know, the problem, isn't it? Let's speed up our empowerment of non-awakening is what we're doing. Let's speed it up. Let's make the distraction more intense. You know, if you're driving and a slow rate of speed and everybody's staying in their lanes, I mean, if you're in the fast lane to the fast lane, the middle lane, and nobody's weaving, really. And everyone's being civil and understanding there's different rates of speed here, okay? And you can relax when you're driving more, and this helps you focus in, you know, it helps you focus in on what's essential. If you're feeling your life is endangered every moment you're driving, which is what I feel now, how can you focus in? It's very difficult. How can you relax? It used to be I enjoyed driving. I was relaxing. I love driving in California. There's no better place. And now it's hell. You feel your life is endangered constantly, constantly. And even the speeders and the weavers have their lives endangered by maniacs. There's another style of driving which are just flat out maniacs. They're people who are basically saying, I can't take it anymore. I'm just going to go as fast as I wanted to go, as if there's nobody else on the road. Literally, you're having these people now who are driving as if there's nobody else on the road. I think they just can't take it anymore. And they're scaring the heck out of everybody. Because they're going like 120. And they're weaving at 120, you know, are just insane rates of speed. And people are telling me that. I said, someone passed me like this, blew my doors off. And I just couldn't believe it, that this is happening. Like, you know, suicidal drivers, you might say. And they literally, you know, people just can't take it anymore here. That is the truth. I understand that. They just flip. They flipped out. And you can see in their driving, they flipped out. And that you're seeing that more and more. Because you can't, it's now basically clogged and congested all the time. And yet people feel an enormous pressure to get somewhere fast also. They're under tremendous pressure here. And they're all jacked up on energy drinks and caffeine, yeah. The nasty kind of caffeine that makes them edgy. Okay, very edgy. People are very edgy. This is the idea that the tech companies want, that they want very edgy, very much into speed. And how do we get to, you know, how do we get there, our software? How do we get this faster? How can we advertise and make more money? Say, we can get you there faster. We can get your task done faster. It's all about speed. Technology is all about faster, isn't it? Mostly. Okay, it's about faster. And so they want their employees totally focused on fasterness. How can we cut in, and how can we get around that one car on the way to work? How can we get the edge, even if it's one car length? How can we get that edge? So this is how they drive. It's some of the stuff you see is just hilarious. I want to be a passenger in a car, which I never am, and take video of this and just videotape the madness of these people, these weavers, where it's complete gridlock and they're still weaving, literally. And they're forcing themselves into some other lane, and then I see them force themselves over some other lane, and they're just trying to get, like, you know, 10 feet ahead. They can't just accept the situation. Is, you know what? Let's just everyone stay in their lanes, and we're just going to go slow. Now, in Los Angeles, there are much better drivers down there. I feel less endangered in Los Angeles than I do here, because they've been in gridlock for the last 30, 40 years. And so everybody is just realized, you know, hey, we're not going to get there faster. You don't have the weavers down there. I know people always criticize LA drivers. I find LA drivers to be fabulous drivers. Now, it's true that you have to be acculturated to it. And when they give you space, you got to get in. Okay, they'll give you space, not much, but they'll give it to you, and they're aware. Okay, you need to get in, or they'll give it to you. But you have to understand that you have to be aggressive and get in there. Once you understand that, then I find LA drivers to be very good, very, very good drivers. Here, we don't have that. We have a combination of people who are flipping out super aggressive and edgy, and then a bunch of people, massive amount of people from other countries, don't even know how to drive here at all. They don't understand, and so you get this toxic brew of nobody trusts one another of what they're going to do. You look at every car now, and you don't trust. You don't know what any car is going to do. This is hell. In Los Angeles, I can trust the drivers. I know what they're going to do. I know the amount of aggression, and I know what they're going to do. Yeah, it's not easy driving in LA. No, okay, but at least you feel some cultural feeling like, okay, you can trust what the other drivers are going to do. But here, again, I'm out there on the road. And I'm looking. I say, I don't know what you're going to do at all. You don't know. And so this is too stressful, driving this way. You realize that driving, there's a certain level of trust in society that you feel you know what other people are going to do. If that breaks down, you're going to have a breakdown, a mental breakdown. You don't know what anyone, how anyone is going to react. This is a part of the problem that, back in the 60s, the older generation, they were very upset about the younger generation because everybody was on drugs, and they didn't know how they were going to act or react or what they were going to say or anything. And this is, this is very, very, very stressful. And you get people now, since there's no law and order here, you get people like from like various Eastern countries, for instance, like Vietnam. There's a lot of Vietnamese here, and some of them are driving like they would drive in Vietnam, except at 90 miles an hour. They're really overly aggressive in their moves. I notice. Wow, the Chinese tend to be overly conservative in how they drive. You might say overly polite. And slowing down, not sure that they'll slow down, don't stop on the freeways and do stuff that you're not supposed to do. The Vietnamese tend to be overly aggressive in their driving. I've noticed, there are called some cultural norms you notice. Anyway, you can get into various cultural norms and people get upset about that stuff. But you see, there are some, various things. But it's the blend of all these different norms, okay? You have to realize there are different norms culturally where you're from. The idea that that if you live in a place you don't have cultural norms is absurd, completely absurd. There is. Wherever you go, you notice, differences in driving habits, right? Absolutely, you do. And this reflects, different cultural norms. It used to be in California, you'd pass somebody and you'd look over and you'd wave. Really, seriously. Like if you're driving on a highway, someone, there's some car going slower, do you say, well, okay, I want to pass them. They might put their hand out the window and wave you by, is what they do. They wave you by. And you're passing, you look over at them and say, smile and say, have a great day. It's like wonderful. Yeah, no, literally, this is how we used to drive here, okay? Just think about the mood that people were in back then. And you'd get somewhere, and everybody's in that mood, like, hey, I had a great trip getting here. I really enjoyed the drive. So you go to a rest stop, you go to some place rest, and people are smiling at each other, and they're looking each other in the eye and smiling and say, hey, how are you? Hey, how was the drive here? Oh, it was great. You had a wonderful drive. How was yours? I bet yours was great too. Oh yeah, it was fantastic. I saw this and that. Oh yeah, I do. And like you're like friends, Strangers are friends, and you're talking about how much you're enjoying life. And you didn't feel any hesitation to wave to anybody. You see somebody, the beach or something. Hey, how you doing? Hey, how's it going? And you're probably have as much fun enjoying the day as much as I have. And say, oh, absolutely, I am. And say, hey, isn't it great that living here? What are you seeing today? and they tell you some things that they're enjoying of the day and give you some pointers. This was California. It's like we're exploring the beauty of the state, exploring this, and we just share this. This is what we did. Now you get somewhere and everybody's like completely freaked out. You go to a rest stop, some fast food place, and you come in there and I'm looking around and it's just like, what in the heck? People from head to toe covered in these, violent tattoos. Wearing clothing and t-shirts with, advocating and killing everybody. They're jacked up on massive drugs and energy drinks. And, like everybody's paranoid. Yeah, and I'm not exaggerating at all. I'm not going to bring a camera in there to catch the people like, what are you doing? But I mean, we get out of these places and say, we got to get out of here. I mean, this is too scary. This is scary. This is the California we live in now, folks. Okay. Literally. Not an exaggeration. You go to a gas station and you feel like, I just want to get my gas in my car and get out of here. Because the people are too weird. They're trying to lose their, they're trying to self-medicate because the stress is too much. And they're unstable. And you don't like look around and talk to people at a gas station very often anymore. I still do. I still try to. But most of the time, it's like people are looking, it's like, are you dangerous? Are you dangerous? And the women are all freaked out because they feel this sense of endangerment everywhere, right? They tend to be normally kind of jittery out in public. And so they're all jittery. Like, are you some crazy, drug addict, freaked out person or something? And then when they're all jittery, then you start feeling jittery. Like why are they looking at me that way? Like I'm some threatening person. Am I threatening, And women didn't used to be that way in California. Not at all. So women are super edgy here, super, super edgy, which makes men feel like they're all defensive and edgy too. But, sometimes, like I was at a gas station a while back and some woman, came up high and talking and traveling. Well, they're from like Canada, British Columbia. And so she didn't have any edginess at all. She didn't feel threatened by him. She wasn't looking at me like, oh, he's threatening. No. He said, oh, here's a nice man. Here's a nice fellow traveler, of enjoying on the road here and talk about the travel and talk about how great the day it is and share some information. That's the way women used to be here. But the California women, the rat race of the whole thing, they were not that way at all. It's like, you don't dare come up and approach me or say anything. They don't come up to you and say anything. No way. No way. You're like an enemy. Potential enemy. Dangerous. So, so they're just trying to make their house a fortress, Didn't used to be that way. Now the wealthy people escape the state and go other places where it's not that way. But if you're not wealthy and you can't escape, you're in hell. So that's why people are obsessed with going faster and making more money, right? I mean, it's like money is king here. It's king and queen, and they realize, well, we just got to get out of here. But the rest of the world is catching up to all this too, isn't it? Tattoos are an expression, external expression of what's going on inside your mind. So when you see these tattoos, that's a scary thing. What's going on in their mind is very scary, isn't it? The thoughts they're having. Just like driving is an expression of what's going on in our personality, so are all these tattoos, how people dress, the statements they're trying to make on their shirts and whatever, right? Very, very, very scary and intense. I mean, basically they're saying, my inner landscape is hell. Because I live in a brutal inner landscape. I enjoy tourists, you know, people come over from like Japan or some various places, wherever, and you know, they'll smile at you and you can walk and talk, and you know, it's like, oh, you know, wow, at last some people who don't think that I'm a potential maniac or something. You know, California's now reviewing each other, and everyone's a maniac here. That's not, I don't like that. That's not healthy. Why should we have to live in such a hellish situation? And you know, it's useless to say, well, let me go to Costa Rica or something, because it's globalizing. The whole thing is globalizing. It's a global nightmare, a shared nightmare. It's just you get it here in California first. Money is king. Power is king. The king to, you know, to escape some of this pressure. Go to an island somewhere. You know, the rich people, tech people, what they do, they buy islands, okay? They're literally. They are buying islands. There's a lot of islands in this world, more than we realize, actually. There may be hundreds of thousands of islands. There's all sorts of small islands in the world. And their own people are buying these islands. And these tech people are buying islands. I mean, what was it, Lanai or something, one of the Hawaiian Islands? You know, one of the tech barons here in Silicon Valley bought the island. He owns the island. That's their getaway. See, they know how to get away from it. They realize this is insanity. Do you think they hang out too much in this stuff? No way. They're on their islands. They have their fortresses on their islands, and they control their empire, you know, through their subordinates electronically and stuff. They're in yachts cruising the ocean, folks. Or they're underground. They have the underground hideaways too, but they own these big yachts. There's a massive amount of luxury yachts. They own the yachts. They're out cruising the Mediterranean or Pacific, wherever they are. And they're away from this. I mean, getting out in the ocean, it's like you feel, oh, I mean, that must be, I've never done that, but that must be, feel pretty awesome to be able to cruise like that and just get away from it all and surround yourself with beauty and luxury and peacefulness, right? But, and yet they're the ones who are reaping all the money from this insane insanity and yet insulating themselves from it. If they were not able to insulate themselves from it, they might sing a different tune about it all. And those who are not, some of their subordinates, they realize, hey, this is terrible. And they may be the ones that wake up, but the ones that are insulating themselves in luxury and comfort from the money, they don't have motivation to wake up from it, you know, from it. They don't. The last will be first and the first will be last, you know, like that. The first will be last and the last will be first. When you're not able to insulate yourself from it, then you say, wow, this is hell. How do I really escape this? If I can't escape it through money, how do I actually escape from it? This is a very good question to ask yourself. And so this is why, you know, I'm driven to escape, really escape from it, because I'm not able to insulate myself from it at this point. Now, I may need to pragmatically, just because from my age, you know, it's just killer stress on me now. My job is so stressful. You know, it's like the worst possible situation for me. So that script may need to be flipped. I would say it really needs to be flipped. And the Dharma King may flip it for me if he sees that, you know, is helpful. Just like, look out throughout history, you'd have these princes and princesses, they have these realms, these small principalities, okay? Now, they are under the umbrella, if they want to be. Some of them are independent, but when they were threatened by like some invasion, you know, here come the Mongols or the Tartars or whatever, from the steppes or, you know, from parts unknown, and they coming in on their horses with their advanced warfare techniques and bringing the Black Plague with them and all this horrible stuff. It was really, throughout history, you know, so many, many invasions. The princes would say, okay, I'm going to battle them, and I want to retain some independence. And they realize, oh my gosh, my principality is being wiped out. Or they realize these other princes have been wiped out, and the prince is fleeing and say, oh, you can't withstand this invasion. And the prince says, huh, what should I do? And then they may say, okay, well, there's this king here that has this bigger kingdom with a lot more warriors and stuff. So I'm going to go to this king and petition, will you accept my warriors and my principality as part of your kingdom? In exchange, I'll give my army, you know, under your direction, and I'll accept your protection in terms of my loyalty to you. And that's what happened. That's what happens. And so now you're a prince of the realm of the king. And then you're protected by the king's might and power, okay? But you're also, you know, using, you know, those who are loyal to you, then you may be a general or leading, you know, protection of this bigger kingdom. This is how it's worked throughout history, right? So we certainly know how this works. So if you're a prince, you know, you may need to realize at some point, you need to ally yourself and form an alliance with a Dharma king. A Dharma king has tremendously powerful grace, who can cut through the spiritual red tape like that, you know. There's no red tape for them. Now, I have been warned, this renaissance that I'm being warned about, it's always in red. It's always accompanied by red lettering or red symbols. So what I think is likely to happen is there's going to be a renaissance of communism. Keep in mind that back in the Mao was the 50s, right? The communist revolution against in China. I think it was from 1950, and then it something like that. And then 59 was when the Tibetans, you know, mostly fled Tibet. I took over Tibet by that point. And then the 60s was the real radical, you know, Soviet Union Marxism and then communism, Marxist communistic. That got into the universities of the West. And we had these, you know, a lot of students were Marxists here. And they had Mao's little red book. Literally, they wore their Mao caps and stuff. And, you know, you had global revolution, global Marxism was on the march, right? Latin America, all over the world. It was very chic and very, very popular among juveniles, which was what? It was a rebellion against authority and law and order, wasn't it? Said, look, we're all going to have equal status under the law. There's not going to be some group, you know, well, this is juvenile, extremely juvenile, but the juveniles were really into it. I can tell you this, that Marxism was very chic growing up in the 60s and 70s. The intellectuals, if you were smart, you were a communist or Marxist. That was a sign of how intelligent you were. Now, I never went into that because I said, no, it's spiritual truth. The real smart people are into spiritual truth and non-dualism, not any sort of social, political ideology at all. So I was kind of insulated from that by my perspective. So there was this bloom of communism in the world, and people in Europe too said, this is it, socialism, communism, this is it. Then what happened was there was a backlash against that as people started realizing, wow, you know, Pol Pot and some of the stuff in Latin America, and so he said, well, wait a minute, you know, maybe this isn't it. And so we had the age of return to capitalism, like under Ronald Reagan, for instance, where, you know, the Soviet Union broke up, right? The capitalism won the Cold War, is what happened. And this drove all these Marxists sort of underground. But now, you're having a return with the recession that hit and the greed of Wall Street and all this kind of stuff, you know, the hatred against the one percenters and all this things. You're having a huge return now to communism, Marxist communism. The president of the United States is a Marxist, plain and simple. He's really a naked Marxist, among other things. He grew up in that age where that was hip, that was cool. And you know, he's a liberation theologist, really, a Marxist, a reparationist, actually. And other things as well, as well as an elitist, one percenter himself, the whole ball of wax. You can go on and on and on. It's not a pretty picture, actually. But that's what that personality, that's where it's at. That's what it is, okay? So, and he's been helping lead this return. The Pope is a Marxist, okay? Plain and simple. So both the Pope and the President of the United States are naked Marxists. This is leading a renaissance of communism, return to communism in the world. I call it yoga girl communism. It's sort of being camouflaged by putting women in charge of it. And we think, oh, the juvenile attitude is well, you know, mother knows best. At least mom treats me okay. I don't like dad's rules, right? It's always like dad's the bad guy. Mothers are very clever, especially juvenile mothers are very clever to always make the man do the disciplining and lay down the rules so she retains this idea of she's the good one. Okay, she wants to stay on the good side of her children by that. Then she knows that juveniles hate these rules, so she doesn't want the juvenile hating her, so she'll make the man lay down the rules for the kids, and the kids will hate their fathers. This is what happens. The women who do have the integrity to lay down the rules themselves, well, actually, the children end up hating their moms. But all kudos to them having the guts to do that, having the integrity to do that. Because most women use the trick of having the man play the heavy. Good cop, bad cop thing. And so children grow up hating men. And during the 60s, in the 70s, with this Maoist revolution, we grew up hating our fathers, you know, because and thinking that mothers were nice, mothers are cool, mothers are, yeah, they're on our side. No, we were just being deceived. The mothers wanted us to grow up and everything, but they just had the fathers do all the discipline. So we got this very unbalanced idea of negativity towards males and men. Very, very dishonest and disingenuous. And it is part of growing up to realize that the deceit, that mothers are very deceitful and don't know best at all. They're very tricky. And they want your behavior to be a certain way, but they'll have somebody else play the heavy to force you into the behavior that they want you to have and still pretend that they're the good ones, that they're on your side. You know, it's very deceitful. You might say that mothers knows best. A better way to put it is mothers deceive best. Is a better way to put it. Mothers deceive best. Okay, the men are much more straightforward and less deceitful than that. They are. They go, you want me to discipline? Okay, this is the way I want you to be. This is what you should do. It's just plain and simple. Come on. I don't have time to fool around. I got to go to work. They don't have time for all this Machiavellian stuff, you know. Most men don't. Not the time for that. Let's cut to the chase here. So, really the motto might be mothers deceive best, which is why they're being put in charge of this communism, this renaissance of communism. Renaissance is a renaissance. Nascent means emerging. You know, it's a nascent trend. It's a trend that is emerging. Renaissance is a reemergence. Renaissance really means a reemergence. And so, what I'm getting is this intense depiction from the Holy Spirit. This gave me just an intense flurry. I'm sitting there and I turn around. I turn to my side. There's a truck right next to me, right on the truck, Renaissance in bold red colors. Someone gives me a card, a business card, Renaissance on it in bright, bold red colors. There's another truck, Renaissance, and there's this huge symbol in bright red. Every time it's in bright red, Renaissance. Well, if you know your symbology in terms of what the Holy Spirit uses symbology we can relate to, red China is associated with communism. Growing up, the Red Book, Little Red Book, it was all about red. That was their color. So, you know, socialism uses red. So it's a reemergence of the reds, which is communism. But it's, I call it very aptly, yoga girl communism, because they're blending spirituality with it. They're saying, no, this isn't communism. This is just really heightened spirituality. We have a heightened understanding now. We all need to help the earth. So we all have to be on the same page and be controlled, essentially. You know, it's environmentalism meeting communism and getting together and say, hey, wait a minute. You know, we're screwing up completely. We all need to be controlled. So how do you do that? Well, mother knows best, or mother deceives best. Put mother, big mother, in charge of this global communism. And this is exactly what we're going to get here if we don't get chaos first, which they certainly want to have chaos, so that they can then claim, oh, look, you're out of control, therefore we have no choice but to really crack down on you. The communists are experts at agitating. What they do is they go into an area, they agitate. Well, so is the CIA, maybe. Yeah, they're both sides, but they agitate, they cause chaos in a country, and then they come in and say, look, you don't know how to govern yourself. We're going to have to establish law and order here. That's a divine right, you know, of rulers, is to establish law and order. You're not handling your business here. Absolutely, they do that. In fact, the propaganda agitation is the heart and soul of socialism, communism, of how they take over countries and how they take over the world is what they want. Don't be surprised if there's some big propaganda agitation, so that then they can claim, wow, you see, you're out of control, you're going to ruin the world, this is not working, and we need to step in, and but we'll be nice about it, because here's mother, she's not the heavyweight, she's not bad, right? She'll make sure that you get your candy, get your treats. Oh yeah. And this is what's coming. Holy Spirit's made it very clear. There's going to be a reemergence, a powerful reemergence of communism in the world. But it's going to be yoga girl communism. Very interesting meme, or meme, whatever you want to call it, meme. Circulating now of Trump as a guru, okay? Very interesting. Very, very interesting. Because it's likely that, you know, Yoga Girl is going to win the presidency. Yoga Girl Miss Yoga Girl Communism International is going to win the presidency of the United States. And at that point, the Pope, the ex-president, President Emeritus, and then the Yoga Girl Communist President uninhibited communism is just going to have this roaring reemergence in the world, a roaring renaissance, and win the battle. And what's everyone else going to do who doesn't want to do that? Hey, turn to spiritual, genuine spiritual focus. So this picture of Trump as this meditator in an orange robe, Buddhist getup, in a cave meditating, is very interesting. Maybe in the back of our minds, people are saying, you know, I may have to retreat to a cave and meditate is what I may have to do to avoid this communistic world, which is beyond what communism we're aware of. It's actually an insane amount of control over our lives under the rubric of, well, you know, you got to save the planet. Our planet's going to be destroyed if we don't do this. What they're really saying is we have to empower non-awakening because we feel so threatened by the emergent spirituality of the 60s and 70s and, you know, 50s too. There was this emergent spirituality and they felt so threatened by it. They needed to push this green revolution and make an excuse about there's too many people, the world's being destroyed, we need to control everybody. I mean, there's ways of helping an environment without going communist, folks. Hello? Right? They're just shrewdly using this for their purposes. It's a paranoid purpose they have. They're spiritual paranoids. Yes, the globe is under too much stress because there's too many people. Okay, that is well, even that could be managed, actually. If we turn to a genuine spirituality, it would be easily managed. They're just exploiting this global thing. I mean, the Green Revolution certainly produced too many people, and we're living longer is also part of the problem. And everybody has to go faster, which is part of the problem. But there are those who have told me, yes, it can be managed. And I trust what they say. I believe it can. I think they're right. I feel that they're right. There is a way to manage it without going communist, okay? But what really is the paranoids are just using this, spiritual paranoids, to control everybody. And to defend, to empower non-awakening. That's what's really happening. And I'm not denying that aren't global problems environmentally. Of course there are, very severe. But again, there are spiritual ways of dealing with that, rather than control freak paranoid ways. People could go to caves. That would solve a lot of problems, wouldn't it? Live much simpler lifestyles. Empower simple lifestyles. Not by putting us into a techno straitjacket, okay? Not a paranoid straitjacket, no. Just make it chic and acceptable to live this very simple contemplative lifestyle. And say, this is what's really smart, this is what's really wise, this is what's really environmentally empowering, environmentally helpful, all this stuff. And focus on empowering awakening. Okay. But make that the focus, and the whole world would change, and our habits would change in such a way that the environment would respond. And we call on the grace of God, the environment would heal itself, actually. Or, ultimately, we wouldn't even need this environment of a world. We'd go to a reduced intensity zone, which is a pristine environment, and let this world heal up, too. There are many options other than paranoid yoga girl communism. That's the worst option. That's the worst option. Yoga girl paranoid communism is the worst option there is. And this is what the Holy Spirit's telling me, this is what's going to happen. So we have this graphic of Trump in a cave as a Buddhist guru, really. I mean, we might call Trump Rinpoche. Tulku Trump. We might say Tulku Trump, or Trump Rinpoche or something. This is actually, you know, this is kind of an awakening among people. It's like saying, hey, wait a minute. You know, interesting, isn't it? Very, very interesting. But I do have to say that people's spiritual attitudes are extremely juvenile now. And at some point, you have to shift out of that juvenility, and you say, "Okay, I'm that's it. It's finished." You don't stop instantly being juvenile, but your attitude, your fundamental commitment, has shifted. So I say, 2016 is a year of commitment. Our fundamental attitude has to shift, and then we start working on these juvenile habits and overcoming them. We're spiritual juveniles, okay? We have to realize this is where we're at. We're very juvenile spiritually. And some of these people came from Tibet. They look, they just shake their heads and say, "This, I mean, wow." So juvenile. And some of them are becoming juvenile too. They're being infected by it. They get caught up in it. You can hardly blame them. You hang out with juveniles too much, you start becoming a juvenile. It gets to you. And this is why these Dharma kings are so important, is they cannot be pulled down. Okay, this is why I say take refuge in the court of the Dharma king, is they'll keep you, you know, they'll keep you on the straight and narrow as far as what you need to do. And they won't let you slip down into juvenility. This is the protection we need. We need protection from the juvenile, yoga girl, paranoid communists. You know, I'm sounding like some, you know, Joe McCarthy. Oh, the communists. Nah, you know, Joe McCarthy was right about a lot of what he said, okay? He was sounding the joke, says, hey, we're under siege right now. He was right. And, of course, the communists hated him because he was right. They tried to portray him as some paranoid or something. So, you know, somebody has to be mature enough to speak up and say, we are really in big trouble here. These yoga girl juvenile paranoid communists are taking over the world, and they want to rule our lives. And Trump is saying, whoa, 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 wait a minute, not so fast, I don't want you to rule my life. You know, and a lot of people are saying the same thing. I don't want you to rule my life. Now, I don't want Trump ruling my life either. Okay, let's make that clear. But I don't feel he really wants to rule my life. he wants to do his thing. But I mean, if I'm on a golf course, he's not going to come up to me and tell me how to play golf. You know, he just says, "All right, you want to, you know, hit this is your style playing golf. Fight. I got my style. You got your style. It's all good. It's all good." Not a problem. But again, I don't want Trump ruining my life. You know, and most people don't either, right? They, you know, that's okay. But so we need to make a shift out of juvenility is what needs to happen. And usually you don't do that until there's an aha moment that hits you in your life. And that driving my car up a street at 50 miles an hour, and someone's screaming at me, "You're gonna kill somebody!" That was my aha moment, and I just, it hit me. At first, I was really like, "How dare they speak to me like that? Who are they?" And then I just had this moment, like a Holy Spirit moment, a grace-filled moment of saying, "Who am I to be dishonest in this way? Who do I think I am? I'm being dishonest with myself. Who am I to think that being dishonest is okay? I am driving too fast. They're right. I'm wrong." That's it. That's the bottom line. So you suddenly have this point of, I'm going to just be honest with myself. And that's the end of juvenility. Juveniles are very dishonest with themselves. They're very overconfident. They have severe mental problems, actually, mental issues. They're very, very dishonest and overconfident. Oh, these drugs don't hurt me. Oh, I can do this. That's being dishonest. That's being very dishonest. So you have this aha moment. Now, if Trump can help us with this aha moment, fine. Whoever can help us with this, I don't care who it is. I'm not idolizing Trump or anything like that. I don't care who it is. But whoever can help us have this aha moment, realize I got to be honest with myself and stop being so juvenile. Now, the yoga girl paranoid juvenile communists are projecting all of the blame for this. Of course, they always project blame onto the one percenters, you know, the capitalists. They're the ones who are destroying the world. They're to blame. And so they have a nice scapegoat there so they don't be honest with themselves and realize they're the paranoid control freaks. They're even worse. They're worse. Yeah, the one percenters aren't cool, okay? But the yoga girl juvenile paranoid communists are much worse, leading us much further astray. And it's never their fault. Keep this in mind. It's never their fault. It's never a juvenile's fault. They're never to blame, are they? Never. Juveniles can do no wrong, right? That's the juvenile attitude. They're very dishonest. At least the one percenters, you can tell them, hey, you know, you're this nasty dude, blah, blah, blah. They'll say, well, yeah, there's some, you know, I am very selfish and greedy, and I do have this problem, and, you know, okay, you can tell me that. And almost sneezed there. I mean, you could push back. I could say, hey, Trump, I think you're completely crazy about this certain thing. And he'd say, okay, why? Why do you think that? And I can give him some reasoning and, you know, and say, well, you know, you might have something there. And, you know, you feel like there's still, you know, there's still some reason there, like they might be able to accept some responsibility and shift. So the yoga girl, juvenile, paranoid, communist, you know, you don't get any of that. So whatever can help us have this aha moment, says, I got to be honest with myself. I have to start practicing. Practice starts with me. And I need to start maturing spiritually here. And if it means going to a cave, I'll go to a cave. Might even be fun. It might be fun to live in a cave for a while, right? I mean, caves can be quite nice, really. Just go to your spiritual cave. That's what I did. I lived in a spiritual cave for a long time. It was my room in the suburbs, but it was a spiritual cave. And I really matured in that cave. I started becoming more and more and more honest and realized, hey, these Dharma kings and queens, they know what they're talking about. They're the ones who really know what they're the ones who deserve my attention. Not these yoga girl, paranoid juvenile communists. They don't deserve my attention at all. Why do they deserve my attention? They're just trying to exploit me to empower their own non-awakening. And that's just, you know, absurd. Absurdity doesn't deserve our loyalty and attention. It's these great teachers who are non-absurd. They're not absurd at all. They're telling me the truth. And so I realize, hey, Jesus is telling me the truth. These teachers are telling me the truth. Not the Jesus of the religion, but the real Jesus. He's telling me the truth. The Holy Spirit's telling me the truth. These great Dharma kings and queens are telling me the truth. They're telling all of us the truth. They're the real deal. They're the ones I need to listen to. This is honesty. So Trump is not some guru, spiritual guru. You know, he's got some juvenile issues of his own, doesn't he? But he's not. He's also got some maturity. Also, he takes criticism extremely well. You know, it's amazing, and the pushback and hostility towards him, you know, to keep your cool, you know, it's really something. You can't do that to a yoga girl, paranoid juvenile communist. I mean, you start criticizing them, they'll put you in jail, and you'll never see, you know, they'll put you in the black hole of Calcutta. You'll never see the light of day again. I mean, they're super brittle and fragile. I mean, you know, you need to kowtow to them. You know, you say, I don't like the way you're dressed. You know, I mean, you feel like they're on the urge of chopping your head off. You know, it's unbelievable how sensitive they are. I mean, Trump, people are just hurling every hideous hatred towards him imaginable. And he's still affable. You know, I mean, you know, that's some maturity right there. That's some, you know, exemplary maturity right there. But again, we need to have an aha moment in our lives. It's not about anyone else. It's about our decision to abandon juvenility because it's dishonest and start empowering our own awakening and decide to do it. If we don't do that, we're lost. we're lost. We're just reacting like juveniles. We're juveniles reacting to other, towards juveniles and calling that good. It's not good. It's, and then we're right back to the dichotomy. It was like, I call the ego God. You call it something else. I'm better than you. They're just arguing over labels. Two juveniles arguing over labels. You know, who's the best guitar player or something. Two juveniles arguing over labels and styles of egoicness. This is dishonest. It's fundamentally dishonest. We're about at the end of this video, right? Another one. And so just keep hearing this. And that aha, when that aha moment comes, you'll know it. And you'll say, ah, I'm going to get out of this mess now. I see that there's a way. Self-honesty is the way, really. You know, partisanship among juveniles is not the way. Juveniles battling other juveniles. Juveniles can be very destructive, very vicious. They really can. They're the worst. That attitude's the worst. So don't argue about it. If someone's not giving, helping you with that aha moment honesty, find someone that does. Find someone that does. Don't criticize the ones that don't too much. Don't waste your time on that. I mean, someone's already done it, the Dharma Prince, let them do the criticizing. The ones that are still very juvenile, you focus on shifting out of that juvenility. Focus on that, okay? You know, the ones who haven't done that are in a different boat than the ones who already have. The ones who already done it and have worked on it are in a different boat, you know? So don't try to compare. Don't try to compare. Understand that there is some quote unquote positive spiritual authority that can tell you and wash you this is what you need to do.